In the 13th chapter of the Apocalypse, we're given a warning about a number 666 and told to calculate what that number is referring to, specifically a name of a beast, an antichrist, an individual opposed to God and his law. For many years, individuals have been calculating this number as the number referring to the Pope's title, Vicarius Filii. This was first figured out about 500 years ago by a gentleman by the name of Andreas Helvig. The question is, though, was the title Vicarius Filii ever an official papal title? Well, let's take a look at the evidence and find out from the history. One thing I want to clear up real fast before we get started with the video. A lot of people say Caesar Nero's name is the one that adds to 666. Case closed, we can go home. Nothing further to add. They do this by taking Caesar Nero, or Nero Caesar, and they add an N, so it's Neron Caesar, and then they transliterate it into Aramaic, resulting in NRWNQSR, which in the equivalent of the letters, you have Nun equals 50, Resh 200, Wa 60, Nun 50, Kaf 100, Samech 60, Resh 200. The problem is that there's a repeated Nun in there, and in accurate, appropriate Gematria, a repeated Nun, actually the value is 700. So that would throw off Caesar Nero's name to 1316 instead of 666 if you're straight with the Gematria and you use it appropriately. All right, let's get started on what the real 666 is. So one of the first things you need to know is that the Catholic Church denies that this title was ever a papal title. In fact, this particular book right here says that it has been said that the Catholic popes never used the title Vicarius Filii, but the title Vicarius Christi instead. We're going to take a look at the evidence, and you can make your determination on that. This particular article was published by Swearing Kingsley and Chavanez. This was published in 2015. We're going to fact check this today. But first things first, you need to know that the title Vicarius Filii was first found to be added up to 666 over about 500 years ago. In this particular work by a Protestant who went by the name of Andreas Helvig. This was his Antichristos Romanos, and you can get a copy of it on archive.org. But in it, he was one of the first to calculate this papal title and identify it with Antichrist. This man had a lot of wisdom, and he goes into the discussions about Nero as well and how it fits the Pope more than it fits Nero. There's some people that say that 666 is not the right number, that it's actually 616, and they're wrong on that. In fact, Irenaeus himself identified that even the earliest evidence, those who spoke with John face to face in the manuscripts, indicated that it was 666. So this was a particular publication by Erasmus of Rotterdam, published during the Reformation time period. We can see this one was published in 1560 right here. Here's his statements about the testimony of individuals who spoke with Ioan Fasi ad Fasi, and they testified to the fact that it was 600, 366. And he has that listed here in his book, where he says it's 600, 366. So one of the books that had some of the most frequent usage of Vicarius Filii was the Donation of Constantine. So here we see an example of that right here. Vicarius Filii Viter esse obstitutus. Here we have a copy of it here. This is a scan right here, and we back out. This is from digitalesamlungen.de. So this is a scan of the Donation of Constantine, a particular page of it right here. And of course, some people are going to say, well, the Donation of Constantine was a 9th century forgery, and it was made by a guy by the name of Johannes Haimonides, or John the Deacon of the 9th century. The problem with that idea is that this document was relied upon by multiple popes to assert papal primacy, much like the Ignatian letters, which were thought by reformers to be forgeries as well. The problem is that this document, though it was later admitted to be a forgery, was initially promulgated and accepted by no less than 10 popes. And we can see even when an individual came along and tried to expose it as a forgery, Rome came behind them and condemned that individual in the Index Librorum Prohibitorum. So here we have a whistleblower by the name of Laurentius Valla, who published a book exposing the donation of Constantine right here. And his book was put on an index of prohibited books in 1664. Rome didn't like the fact that she relied upon this forgery by multiple popes to assert papal primacy, and they didn't like that fact that they were exposed to such. So this was the book right here that finally exposed the donation of Constantine as an admitted fraud by a Catholic official. It was the Apparatus ad Annales Ecclesiasticos. And one of the things that I want to point out here is the apparatus. We can see V's were interchangeable with U's in the Latin language. This is a well-known fact. Adventu Filii Dei. So U's and V's are interchangeable, especially when you're talking about like titles or big names, that kind of stuff. So this particular book is available on Google Books. Cesar Bonarius was the one who finally admitted that the donation of Constantine was a fraud. The usage of the title extends even to documents that are publicly available on vatican.va today. So this is the Paulus Episcopus Servum Servorum Dei, or an apostolic constitution here, and we can get a translation of this right here. Bishop Paul, servants of God to perpetual remembrance of the matter and apostolic constitution, Baftian. And here we see the vicar and procurator of our adoring Son of God, to whom he gave the eternal deity of the Holy Church. So this is Adorandi Dei Filii Vicarius et Procurator. Vicarius Filii Dei, the vicar of the Son of God. That would be the title of the Pope, and it's used in this document here today. But it's not the only Vatican document that's publicly available that has this title. In the Acta Apostolicae Sedis, we can see this title being used as well. Let's go ahead and text search the document real fast and locate it. All right, so Vicarius. There we go. And it's got the Paulus Episcopus usage in it as well. So we can see here that this title was used by the Pope here, and it's available on multiple links here to this document on vatican.va. Now, some people will say that, well, Vicarius Filii Dei is not an official title. It's actually Vicarius Christi, and they have a problem with that, because if we go back to the Latin Vulgate, to Leviticus 24, verse 18, we can see here that the word for substitute is vicarius. This particular copy or Bible is a Gutenberg Bible. It's available on archive.org. It's a 1462 Gutenberg Bible, a Latin Vulgate. And this is the particular Leviticus statement right here. If we zoom in, here we can see Vicarius redit animale. And this particular Bible verse has to do with, if any man kills an animal, he must repay for it life for life. And the challenge here is the life for life. If we go to a Greek version of the same 18th verse, and you can open your Bible and look this up, the word life for life is life anti life, or a life anti. So anti is replacement, and anti being the substitute. In the same verse, you have in the Latin and the Greek, you have vicarius for substitute, or you have anti. So there's this connection there, this undeniable connection between anti and vicarius. Well, then if you put the title Antichristos and you have Vicarius Christi, it's one of the same thing. Again, a substitute for Christ, you have either Antichristos, which is Antichrist, or you have Vicarius Christi, which they admit is a papal title. So it really doesn't help them much to say Vicarius Filii Dei is not an official papal title, but Vicarius Christi is, because that literally means Antichrist. Here we have a fine example of Pope Leo, who quoted heavily from the donation of Constantine in supporting his own power. And this is another usage of the title in referring to the Pope of Rome, Petrus in Terris Vicarius Filii Dei. So here we have Petrus in terris, Vicarius Filii, viditor esse constitutus, ita etiam et pontifices, ipsius principis apostolorum vice. So this is another usage right here, quoting and relying from the donation of Constantine. Relying upon a lie to prove papal authority or papal primacy. What's interesting about this document is that it is publicly available from Documenta Catholic Omnia, and it is a Leo the Ninth Epistolae et Decretalium, I believe. Let's back up to the title page so we can see what that looks like. But it's available on a Catholic website, and it has the Epistolae et Decreta Pontificia from Leo the Ninth. Here we have another copy of Sacrosancta Concilia ad Regiam. This would be Pope Leo the Ninth again. It's available on Google Books. Here we have a copy of him quoting the donation of Constantine again. Petrus in terris, Vicarius Filii, viditor esse constitutus. So this is available multiple places. We're not photoshopping anything or creating anything here. It's available for all to see. This right here is a copy of Pope Innocent III's Intercorporalia. He actually claimed that as the vicar of Jesus Christ, only the Roman pontiff could remove or transfer bishops, as he acted not with human but with divine power and authority reserved for the Roman pontiff alone. And we can see his claims to that. Non enim humana sed potius divina poteste. So he talks about the authority of the Pope and that being equal or on par with the authority of God. And this is where he first popularized the title Vicarius Christi, which, as we've seen, if we connect with Leviticus 24 verse 18, that literally means Antichrist. This particular document is from Pope Nicholas II in 1278. His Fundamenta Militantis Ecclesiae, or Fundamentals of the Militant Church, I would assume. It's a papal constitution. It was issued July 18, 1278. He decreed that the city of Rome was to be governed by a Senate composed of Roman citizens, but only with his express papal approval. Again, ruling like kings. And on this particular document, this references the Roman pontiff as a Vicarius Dei right here. And we get to see that blasphemous title right there, Vicarii Dei. Curse the bottom of 132 in the reader edition. This is from UCLA right here. And we see that title going as well. This particular document right here is from Pope Nicholas IV in 1289. It's his letter to Cadonius the Tartar. Pope Nicholas IV, he wrote a letter, July 13, 1289, inviting Cadonius the Tartar to embrace the Christian faith, assuring him that the Roman Pontiff's office of Vicar of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was in fact a divine appointment. And here we see that title, Vicarius Enim Jesu Christi Filii Dei. And this particular letter is available on the Pontificarium Constitutionium in Bullaris Magno et Romano, Volume 2. And it's available on Google Books. This particular document is one from Augustinis Triumphus from 1243 to 1328, his Summa Potestate Ecclesiastica. He was a 14th century canon lawyer, and he applied Vicarius Filii to the Pope. He was actually commissioned by Pope John XXII to produce a book that would set forth and defend ecclesiastical and temporal authority of the papacy. The result was this book right here, which was completed in the year 1320 and dedicated to the same pope. It's kind of the high water mark of papal pretensions. And we've got, it has over 600 double column pages in early printed editions. It has 112 questions divided into three major parts. And it's held by about 55 libraries worldwide. But we're going to take a look at this book right here and open it up and see what's in it. So this is the reader right here from Bayerische Staatsbibliothek. We can see some handwriting in it initially here in the first few pages. But it uses the papal title Vicarius Filii quite often. Right here, for example, Vicarius Dei, Esse Vicarius Dei, uses various formulations of it throughout. So this particular copy, Vicarius Dei, we see the Vicarius Filii Dei all throughout. Let's take a look and see if we can find it right here. All right. So Vicarius Dei, Papa et Vicarius Dei. We can see another version of it right here, Vicarius Filii Dei. So there's the full title right there, Vicarius, a Vicar of the Son of God. And then we can see right here, let's see if we can find it real fast, Vicarius Dei Filius, or the Filius, which is the another name for son, Vicarium et Dei Filii. So we see various versions of it in Vicario right here. Let's take a look at another version of it right here. Vicarius Dei or Vicarius Christi. This version again. And another version of it right here. Let's see if we can find it real fast. Jump out at me on the page. Here we go. Papa Dei Filii Vicarii. So again, another version of the Vicar of the Son of God right there. This particular document right here is a 1476 edition of the Summa de Potestate Ecclesiastica. And again, we can see the same title, multiple versions. Vicarius Filii Dei videt esse constitutus. So it's the same scan of it, and this particular copy is available on Gallica, BNF, Summa de Potestate Ecclesiastica, Augustinus de Ancona, and this is page 245. In case you didn't want to go to some obscure German library, you can get this available on Google Books as well. This is a 1584 edition of Summa de Potestate Ecclesiastica. And we can see right here, you can search, text search, OCR text search for the term Vicarius Filii Dei. Here's an example of it right here. And this is Sicut bi Petrus in terris Vicarius Filii Dei videtur esse constitutus. So again, that same kind of language right there, Vicarius Filii Dei. We can see evidence of the title here. And this was a licet juxta doctrinum, Pope John the 22nd, October 23, 1327, where he used the title Vicar of the Son of God, Jesu Christi Vicarius, and so the title was used in German documents as well. Here we see another evidence of it, again from the 1327 statement by Pope John the 22nd right here. Bitus videtur in terris Vicarius Dei Filii Constitutus. And ex hoc enim sequitur evidentur, quod Petrus caput universalis ecclesiae, potest dici juxta morum ilium sacrae scripturae. So this is available, this is the Thesaurus Novus Anecdotorum, Tomus Secundus. And we can see this particular edition, let's clear the search and go back up to the top and see when this book was written right here. This is the Thesaurus Novus Anecdotorum, Tomus Secundus right here. And this is Pope IV Epistolae, and again listing some of those previous popes as well. You're looking at probably 17th century right there as far as documenting that. This particular document was published January 18th, 1459. This is the Exequabilis from Pope Pius II. And we see his statement right here where he says, Jesu Christi Vicario, from the Roman Pontiff, the Vicar of Jesus Christ, to whom it was said in the person of the Blessed Peter, feed my sheep, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. This is his statements on that right there. In 1559, Alphonsus Alvarez Guerrero published his Thesaurus Christianae Religiones. He was a Spanish civil and canon lawyer, noted for his expertise in antiquities of the church and advisor to King Philip II of Spain and Naples. And he twice applied the title Vicarius Filii Dei to the Pope, asserting the authority of the Pope over the Holy Roman Empire. And this is a copy of his book right here, available on Google Books. using both the title Vicarius Christi and Vicarius Filii side by side. And those were seen to be interchangeable. This is Alfonso Alvarez Guerrero in his Thesaurus Christianae Religionis Speculum Sacrorum Summorum Romanorum. And here is that cover page for you right there, is Thesaurus Christianae Religionis. This particular work was published by Cardinal Juan de Torquemada in 1561, his Summa de Ecclesiae. He was a Spanish theologian and member of the Dominican order. His monumental Summa de Ecclesiae defended papal supremacy and infallibility and strongly opposed the conciliaris. General Torquemada, the Grand Inquisitor, was his nephew. So this is a copy of that book right here by Cardinal Juan de Torquemada, and he was a cardinal, and his book's available on archive.org. It's available on Google Books in this case. This particular copy is published in 1581, the Summa Sacriae Theologiae, Antonio Archibispo Florentini, and he was the Archbishop of Florence. It was published in Venice. This particular copy right here includes the quotes as well, Vicarius Filii. Here we have another work here. Pope John the 22nd was called Vicarius Filii in 1669 and 1718. We have a copy right here from Ludovico. This is actually Paulus right here. And here we have the Vicarius Filii. And let's back up to the cover. Get this copy right here. It's available on Google Books. You can check it out. Clavis Aureae. Well, commonly used papal title. Here we have a papal confirmation signed off by popes. Here we go. This is John the 22nd in a long celebrated bull called Sabatini, beginning Sacratissimo uti culmine. What the most pious and devout Carmelite Mother of God requested from heaven, the Vicar, the Son of God, ratified and promulgated on earth. Vicarius Filii ratificat et promulgat vit in terris. So Vicarius Filii. And this was endorsed by the Pope himself. This was signed off by the Pope. And you can see right here how the confirmation of the Pope adds additional weight right here. So you can see how multiple popes signed off. And there is that title right there. Again, this was by Rafael Sancto Josefo. And again, just demonstrating how many popes have signed off on this title. This was not a Protestant source right here. This is a Catholic source. This particular work was a defense of the Roman Church and the popes in 1696. We see the usage of the phrase Vicarius Filii sicut Petrus et Leone IX. So we can see again the papal constitutions and the popes who were referenced in using this term right here. This is published, looks like, by Dremain. The Defense L'Église Romaine. Apologies, my folks. My French is not very good, but anyhow, Defense of L'Église Romaine. De Souverain Pontifie. That's my best hope of trying to pronounce anything French. This particular claim was published by Juan Tomás de Rocaberti, and again citing previous popes before him, stating that consequently, since the apostles, with or without a council, he adequately sets forth the articles of faith for the entire world. And there we have the title Vicarius Filii sicut Petrus ex odium et Concilio Florentino et Literalis Unione Armen. But this particular work right here sets forth that papal title, just using it over and over and over again. There's the Bibliotheca Maxima Pontificiae right there. And again, Pope Innocent the 12th and this particular one. We've got popes signing off on these, indicating that they endorse what was within, and you know, these were respected Catholics who were allowing these books to be published, and interesting artwork, but yeah, demonstrating that they did use the title. This particular work is published by Lucius Ferraris, who was a canon lawyer, Vicarius Filii, Vitus Petrus in Terris, and this is another reference to it. He uses the title quite often in this book right here, but references it in various ways. But Lucius Ferraris, Prompta Bibliotheca Canonica Juridica Moralis Theologica. This is his Tomus Septimus, or the 7th edition. This right here is the Annales de Philosophie Christiane. It's in French, it looks like, but it lists different titles, and I think this is very interesting how they do this. But one of the things I wanted to point out here is page 33. Le Papa est le Vicari du Filii de Dieu. So it's a listed like title, it's a listed thing about all these different things that the Pope is. He's the head of the visible church, he's the one of the apostles, he's like established by God to lead and so on. And this is one of his titles, among other things, that he's the vicar of the Son of God. And that's that title right there, Vicarius Filii. Although in this particular version, it's in French. This is the Annales de Philosophie Christiane, Quatrième Série. So yeah, it's a French book right here, but it's available on Google Books. This is a publication called The Vindication of the Popes Against Opponents of All Kinds by Willibaldum Haesium Stadler, 1756 is this particular copy. Quia Jesu Christi Filii Vicarius, per ipse et vida in morte sanctissimo stante. This is Willibald Haes, again, using that same title so many popes before him have used. This particular copy was from Vincent Houndry, the Society of Jesus, or the Jesuits, in 1767. When Honorius II died in 1132, rival groups of cardinals elected two popes, Innocent III and Anacletus II. It took about 8 years for this to resolve, but in the end, Innocent II was declared the valid pope by St. Bernard of Clairvaux. And in this particular statement right here, he says, as to great authority, which St. Bernard had in the church, and the knowledge of it should be noted when Honorius died. The votes of the election of the successor had in an amazing way gone two different directions, and there was seen the same body, two heads upon the same throne, two princes over the same subjects of the Lord. In the same fold, two shepherds, one surreptitious, the other legitimate. There is a usurper here, the true, the verus Filii Vicarius. Vincent Houndry. So the Jesuits use this title. They use it for the Pope as well. This particular copy is the 1767 version. It was also reprinted in 1779 version. And it's available on Google Books. If we scroll back up, we can hit the cover page real fast. There we go. Vincent Houndry, the Society of Jesus, the Society of Jesus right here. This is his first edition. And in 1790, Wolfgang Freilich published Who is Peter? The Supremus Ecclesiae Pastor Christi Filii Dei Vicarius Sancti Petru, successor of St. Peter, the Roman Church, Pius VI. Pius VI was called Filii Dei Vicarius right here. And so let's back up and take a look at this cover page right here. Qui is Petrus? Who is Peter? And it's a definition of who Peter is, according to the Eyes of Babylon right here. All right. This is a French work, the Catechism Perseverance, and here we see the Vicar du Fil de Dieu, which is the Vicar of the Son of God. So it's a French version of the same Vicarius Filii that we see in the Latin. And this was published right here as a catechism, L'Abbé Guam, 5th edition. I'm going to mispronounce the French, but there you go. It was a catechism, Vicarius Filii. And in English, we see the title, Vicar of the Son of God. Cardinal Manning used this term over and over and over for the papacy. Vicar of the Son of God. Vicar of the Son of God. He used it in several instances in this book. On page 141, 230, 231, 232, we see the title, Vicar of the Son of God, in English. This is a three-volume ecclesiastical anthology that actually lists papal names and titles found in various texts of general councils, Gratian decretals, and letters and bulls of the popes. So we have an actual codified list of official papal names and titles that were used. And It's available on Google Books. You want to go to the third edition, which I have blown up right here. And it goes through papal nomen, or papal names. And we can see that exhibited right here and enumerated. Papae nomen. So that would be papal names right here. And they go through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all the different listed enumerated titles of the Pope. But if we go down to number 11 right here, Papa est vicarius filadei sicut Petrus. And there we have it right there. The Pope is the vicar of the Son of God like Peter. And this was a publication of the Pope right here. We're going to back up right here. This is published by, well, not necessarily by a Pope per se, but signed off by a Pope, Giovanni Paolo Paravicini right here. So this was his Polyenthe Sacrorum Canonum Coordinatorum. And Paoli Paravicini right here. It's available on Google Books. One of the things we should discuss before we close is there was an article published back in the early 20th century about papal tiaras having the title Vicarius Filadei on them. And one thing I want to remark is that the Catholic Church has had about 500 years since the days of Andreas Helwig to hide evidence or to remove papal tiaras from existence or from the public's eye. And so it's no surprise we really don't see this title being thrown around out there much these days, even though it did exist for so long back in the day. In fact, there was an Adventist minister who once went to the Papal Vatican and asked to see tiaras. He was only allowed to look at three of them, at which point he was kind of escorted quickly out of the Vatican and not allowed to see anything further. But we do have one tiara in existence. And in June 18th, 1871, the ladies of the royal court of the King of Belgium gave one of the most unique tiaras to Pius IX. It was given in honor of the 25th anniversary of his pontificate. And on that tiara, we do see the words Vicarius Christi in terra regum. And so, as we've seen from papal titles in the documents previously, Vicarius Christi is synonymous with Vicarius Filadei. After all, Vicar of the Son of God is the same thing as Vicar of Christ. And the problem is, as we've seen previously, Vicar of Christ also means Antichrist if we use our Bibles adequately. So there should be no doubt as to what that tiara actually signifies. Were there tiaras previously that did have the Vicarius Filadei on them? I believe there were. And in fact, even as recent as 2015, there have been Catholic news articles online from PhDs within Catholicism that did state, yes, the words inscribed on the Pope's mitre are Vicarius Filadei, even as recent as 2015. Folks, the question is, do you have the wisdom that it takes to calculate the number of the beast, for it's the number of a man, and his number is 600, 3 score, and 6?